sources familiar with Trump's mindset, telling CNN his anger was fueled in part by the Russia investigation, in particular, frustration with his own legal team shifting timelines on when Robert Mueller's probe is going to be done. The Bannon charges in the Michael Wolff book only enraged the president even more. Dana Bash has the new reporting on this. And Dana, you've got new reporting on the president's mindset as he is obviously in an incredible storm of anger over this book. And as we see with his almost 20 tweets in the past day or so.
That's right. And obviously the tweets came first, and they were so over the top, Aaron, so disruptive on several sensitive national security fronts that I and my colleagues, including and especially White House producer Kevin Liptak, set out this morning to find out whether there was something that set the president off and what sources familiar with the president's thinking told us is largely what has been driving the president's behavior is his anger about the Russia investigation, the fact that his legal team told him the special counsel investigation was going to be over likely by the end of the year. Then it was soon, and here he is back at the White House starting 2018 with the Russia cloud still very much hanging over him. And that was exacerbated by the fact that he was coming off a trip to Florida over the holidays, where by all accounts he was relaxed, obviously golfing and in his happy place with his family. And you mentioned this also, but I should note that as we were doing our reporting about the tweets, the news came out about the book, quoting, among other things, Steve Bannon, saying some pretty harsh things about Donald Trump Jr. and others about the Russia investigation, that very raw nerve the president was already upset about.
Right. And, saying money laundering, obviously his finances is the red line the president is seemingly obsessed with. Now, on these tweets, though, Dana, look, the one about the nuclear button was absurd and upsetting to many. That was just one of the tweets that he put out there. How is his team managing this? I mean, did anyone have any clue that he was going to come out and say that mine is bigger than yours?
No, I don't think that was something that was the product of sitting around the cabinet table talking about the best way to reach Kim Jong-un. I was actually told the White House aides have reached out to some who may have influence with the president, especially on national security, to try to convince him that those tweets are just not good for American policy, that they crossed a line that really make him look unstable. Now, I don't know, Aaron, if those messages were actually delivered to the president yet today. So that is unclear. But I also, and this is not going to surprise you, I did not talk to anybody who suggested that the president will ever be convinced to stop tweeting. Not at all.
No. All right. Well, Dana, thank you very much. Panel's back with me. David, it's interesting what Dana says, right, that people are trying to convince him that those tweets could have made him look unstable, right? And then within a few hours, you get these book excerpts come out. The words I use to describe how the book makes Donald Trump look are incapable, disinterested, distracted, paranoid, petty, and petulant. You add unstable to it. It's a pretty bad list. You've been in the White House with four different presidents. Do you recall anything like what we have seen over the past 48 hours for this president, when you have all of these people in his inner circle speaking out so negatively, and you have, of course, that North Korea tweet?
No, I don't recall anything like this ever before. And I'll just tell you this. If Donald Trump were the head of any other major institution in this country, he would be gone by now. The board would not tolerate this kind of behavior, this dangerous kind of behavior. To think that last night, as Dana's report reads, that he was sitting there watching Fox News, he heard this report about North Korea. Within 12 minutes, he typed out, dictated this response on Twitter that was taunting back and was provocative and really rattled the national security community, because that's exactly the way you can get into a conflict when there's childish behavior on both sides. And then 24 hours later, this book comes out and he then dictates this horrible statement that's so unbecoming to a president. I've known presidents to get angry when they normally do is write out something really, really angry. They take that statement and they put it in the desk and that's it. It's done. It's gone. They don't go public. It rattles people, and no board of any major institution would allow this to go on and on and on.
And Tim, Dana's reporting, it comes back to the Russia investigation, which had him as livid as it had him yesterday. And now today in this book, Steve Bannon saying treason, unpatriotic, money laundering, all of that now thrown on top of the fire?
Well, let's step back and, you know, we thought it might be Michael Flynn who would give us the inside information that would turn things upside down. How interesting that it is Steve Bannon on the record. He didn't even have to testify for it to come out. I'm interested in his motives. Very interesting. Why is Steve Bannon turning against the Trump family and the president in this way? I'm not saying that Steve Bannon is lying, but it's interesting. His motives are interesting. You know, we haven't seen this kind of turning against a figure from the inside since John Dean testified against Nixon. When John Dean said that Nixon was part of the cover-up. Bannon, by saying that nothing Don Jr. would do without Daddy getting involved, Bannon was saying the same thing. Bannon is saying that President Trump participated in the discussion with the Russians. So we haven't seen anything like this for a long time, and Bannon's motives are interesting. Yeah.
And what's also interesting, Nia, is that putting aside what the White House said, that this book should be in the bargain basement trash bin or whatever they said, it's a bestseller, and yeah, people want to read it.
People want to read it. It comes out in a week or so. You imagine that there's going to be more and more press about it. There are more excerpts coming out, I think, next week.
Yeah, they have some pretty stunning things
reporter
in them, I believe. Yep.
Exactly, because that's what you want to put out to sell a book. You want to put out the most stunning stuff. So this is what the president, over the next many days, is going to be looking at when he tunes in to Fox News or CNN or whatever he likes to watch. This is what he's going to be hearing.
And I want to point out, there is, as we talk about this, on the Russia investigation, Paul Manafort suing Bob Mueller today,
yeah,
trying to countersue, saying, "Oh, you violated the law in appointing Mueller as special counsel." Whatever convoluted legal argument it is, Tim, does that have any chance of going anywhere, or other than just clouding the waters?
Well, I'm not a lawyer. I don't know. It sounds like clouding the waters. I mean, Mueller and his people are very seasoned at their job. They wouldn't overreach. I find it hard to believe they would overreach.
And Nia, before we go to more on the book, which we're going to have, there is more breaking news. I just want to share this. This is really important for anybody following this president and this nation at this moment. The White House has now announced it has dissolved President Trump's Commission on Voter Fraud.
Yeah, this is big.
By the way, dissolved it, and there was no voter fraud.
Right,
remember,
right,
he said there were millions of votes. Okay, it's gone. It's dissolved. It's over. Guess what? No fraud.
Yeah, they're still claiming, right, in their statement that, you know, there was this voter fraud, but because of these lawsuits, and none of the states were really cooperating with them because there was nothing to cooperate
states with. Republican secretaries of states.
Exactly.
They had no evidence of it.
They had no evidence of voter fraud. But, yeah, it is a pretty stunning turnaround in terms of this. I mean, let's face it. This commission never should have been formed to begin with. This was a sort of paranoid fantasy by the White House and Trump, and then they formed this committee to look into something
and
that didn't exist.
I'm just going to hit pause here, because speaking of paranoid fantasies, we are going to talk more about what's in this book. The president strips his own bed. He has a deep fear of being poisoned. We're going to tell you exactly what that means about what he eats and what he does. And who is more mentally fit to lead, President Trump or North Korean dictator Kim Jong-un? Yes, someone is asking that question tonight.